Let's say a plane is traveling horizontally at 60 meters per second over flat ground at an elevation of 2,000 meters, releases an emergency packet. The trajectory of the packet is given by x equals 60t and y equals negative 4.9t squared plus 2,000 for t is greater than 0, where the origin is the point on the ground directly below the plane at the moment of release. So in this problem, t equals time, and x is our horizontal distance, and y is our vertical distance. So if we wanted to plot this graph, we need to use both equations. So if we looked at time equals 0, we have x equals 60 times 0 equals 0, and y equals negative 4.9 times 0 plus 2,000, which equals 2,000. So we plot that, and that's at time equals 0. Then we can look at time equals 10. So then we have x equals 60 times 10, which is 600, and y equals negative 4.9 times 10 squared plus 2,000, which gives us 1,510. So we can plot that point. If we look at time equals 20, then we have x equals 60 times 20, which is 1,200. And y equals negative 4.9 times 20 squared plus 2,000, which is 40. So if we plot that point, then so this was time equals 10, time equals 20, and then we connect these, we can see our parametric curve. So if we talk about this formally, suppose x and y are both functions of a third variable t called a parameter by the equations y equals g of t and y equals h of t, and these are called parametric equations. Then for each value of t in the domain of g and h, we get values for x and y, which we consider as a point xy. As t varies, the point xy equals g of t, h of t, traces out a curve c, which is called a parametric curve. So we should note that t doesn't necessarily represent time, but this is a useful way of thinking of it. We can think of it as a point or particle that is at g of t, h of t at time t. So in this case, our parametric equations were x equals 60t and y equals negative 4.9t squared plus 20. And this curve that we traced out is our parametric curve. Sometimes it's possible to eliminate the parameter, setting one of our functions equal to t and then plugging it into the other. So in this case, we can solve x equals 60t for t, so x divided by 60 equals t, so y equals negative 4.9 times x over 60 squared plus 2,000. And so now we've rewritten this equation in terms of x and y. We should also note that our parametric curves have a direction. So in this case, time went from 0 to 20 in sort of a clockwise motion. There are two types of curves that we need to be familiar with how to get their parametric equations from their xy equations. The first is circles. So if we have a circle that has radius r and the center hk, then we know that the equation for this circle is x minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals r squared. So the parametric equation for the curve can be written as x equals h plus r times cosine of omega t, and y equals k plus r sine of omega t. So to make sure that these equations are in fact the same, we can subtract h from both sides. So we get x minus h equals r cosine of omega t. If we subtract k from both sides, we get y minus k equals r sine of omega t. Then for each equation, we're going to square both sides. And we can distribute our square in here to r and r cosine or r sine, so that if we add these two equations together, we get x minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals r squared, I'm going to pull that out for both of them, cosine of omega t squared. Plus sine of omega t squared. And usually we see these squareds just above the cosine sign, like so. And we know that cosine squared plus sine squared equals 1. So we have x minus h squared plus y minus k squared equals r squared, which is our equation of our circle. And omega in these equations is the frequency, the angular frequency, which tells us how fast our object is moving. And if omega is greater than 0, then our curve moves in the counterclockwise direction. So you may want to know how they got this equation for our parametric curve. It's obvious that the two are equal, but how did they arrive at it in the first place? So we need to remember our transformations of cosine and sine. So first of all, omega is our frequency, which equals the number of cycles from 0 to 2 pi. So that is the same as our period, our 2 pi divided by t, where t is our period. So when we put our period into our function, remember that we put it in as 2 pi over t, which is the same as omega. So that's where omega comes from. And then the r, well, that's our radius. In our transformations, we called it our amplitude, or the height, but in this case, it refers to the radius. And then the h or k, well, that's the shift right or left in the case of x, and the shift up or down in the case of y. So since we're doing sine, this is then plus k to shift it up k units. So that's where these functions come from. So similarly, we have r cosine of omega t plus h, which shifts it left or right h units. We can also use parametric equations to create equations for line segments. So let's say we have a line segment, and it goes from point P, which is x1, y1, to point Q, which is x2, y2. We want the line segment from P to Q. So we want to let T go between 0 and 1. So we want when t, so this is when t equals 0, and this is when t equals 1. So when t equals 0, we want x to equal x1, and we want y to equal y1. When t equals 1, we want x to equal x2, and y to equal y2. So that tells us that our points must be on the line y minus y1 equals y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1 times x minus x1. So this is our point slope form, where we have our slope and then we have our point on the line. So let's solve this thing for x. So we have y minus y1 being divided by y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1 equals x minus x1. So then we have y minus y1 times x2 minus x1 over y2 minus y1, and then we'll do plus x1 equals x. So now, because we don't want this equation to involve any y's, we're going to let t equal y minus y1 over y2 minus y1. And so then we can write our function x as x equals x1 plus x2 minus x1 times t. But we also know that if t equals y minus y1 times y2 minus y1, then that means that t also equals x minus x1 over x2 minus x1 by solving this equation for t. So that means that our y is equal to y1 plus y2 minus y times t. And so this is our set of parametric equations. And this is for t0. And this is for t goes from 0 to 1. If we have a vertical line, we look like this. So here's our q, here's our p. So this, our x is just a constant. And our y is equal to y1 plus y2 minus y1 times t, for t goes from 0 to 1. Now we are ready to take derivatives of parametric curves. So let's let x equal a function g of t and y equal a function of h of t, where g and h are both differentiable on an interval a to b. Then the derivative of y with respect to x, or the change in y over the change in x, which is the slope of y versus x in the graph, equals the derivative of y with respect to t over divided by the derivative of x with respect to t. Or we can write this as h prime of t divided by g prime of t, or y prime of t divided by x prime of t. And all these are provided that the derivative of x with respect to t does not equal 0. So this comes from the chain rule. If we are looking for the derivative of y with respect to x, so we can rewrite this x equals g of t to be some function in terms of t of x. So we're putting everything except for t on the other side. So then we have a function of t of x. So now we have a function y equals h of t of x. So now the derivative of the outside is the derivative of y with respect to t. That's outside, times the inside is the derivative of t with respect to x. And we should note that dy over dx is the change in y over the change in x, so it's instantaneous. So it's instantaneous velocity, so it's the slope of y versus the slope of x. The derivative of y with respect to t and the derivative of x with respect to t are not the slopes of the graph of y versus x. We can think of these as velocities in the y and the x directions.